Well, praise the Lord. Truly, we thank God for each of you. So what a blessing it is to come into your house one more time. Amen. We pray that you're in good health and God is blessing you in a special, special way. We just give God praise. And I tell you again, as always, man, I miss you. And can't wait to see you face to face. I look for that day. And pray that it will be real, real soon. And so today we want you to be blessed. If you miss Jesus, you guys know you missed it all. And more than anything else, we want you to have that encounter with Jesus Christ. We're blessed today. Minister Pam Kane going to be ministering to us in song. I told her she felt like preaching. Go on, preach. Amen. And also, Rovercomer is back. Amen. So we thank God for Rovercomer coming and being with us. So first of all, we'll just open up with a short prayer. We have Sister Kane to come and minister in song. Then we have our announcement by our pastor or care pastor, Pastor Travis. And then get all the kids ready for Rovercomer, and he's going to be with us. And we just thank God for him coming. And we just want to thank everybody for all the hard work and everything you're doing and how you're blessing us even through these times, and you're blessing the ministry, and we've been able to take care of business. So again, guys, thank you so much for all you do, and I give God praise and thanks for you. Let's pray. Most gracious and eternal God, Father, we thank you for this time. Lord, as we come today, we come to worship you in spirit and in truth. And God, I know that your presence is in each home right now. Fill that house with the Holy Ghost. Wrap your arms of love and protection around each family member. And God, just move. Let your peace, God, fall into today, Lord, that they would know that you are right there with them. God, you said you would be with us even to the end of the world. And Father, we, as we used to say all the time, the church is not a building, but a community of God's people reaching out in love. And God, we know that wherever we are, the church is there. So God, again, take over. Have your way. Lord, we'll never fail to give you the praise. In Jesus' name, amen. Minister Pam Campbell.
Amen. Giving praise and honor to God this morning and just thanking him for allowing us to be here. Thanking him for his strength and his mercy that he gives us daily. And just want to let you know that God is our refuge, and he is our strength. And God laid this scripture on my heart this morning. I've been passing this scripture around to a lot of people in Isaiah 41:10. And he says, "Fear thou not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee, yea, I will help thee. Yea, I will uphold thee with thy right hand of my righteousness." And only God can do that. We can only trust in him and look to him through all that we're going through. And God just laid this little song on my heart. I couldn't find the music. But it says, "I don't know about tomorrow, but I do know that God is holding my hand." I don't know about tomorrow. I just live from day to day, and I don't borrow from its sunshine, for its skies may turn to gray. I don't worry about my future, for I know what Jesus said, and today he walks beside me, for he knows knows what lies ahead. Many things about tomorrow I don't seem to understand. For I know who holds my tomorrow. And I
welcome everybody to our service again, and we're just thanking God that we're able to use our technology to come into your homes and lift up the mighty name of Jesus Christ this morning. So our announcements, tonight we have Reverend Steve Justice will be speaking at 7 p.m. He'll also be doing the Wednesday night service. Tuesday we'll have a check-in Tuesday. We may have a new announcer. The church is open twice a week, Mondays from 10 to 12 and Thursdays from 4 to 6 p.m. You're welcome to come in. The church is open for prayer. Come by worshiping your tithes and givings. And speaking of that, we just want to thank God and give God praise for each and every one of you that's coming by, that's praying, lifting up the mighty name of God, and worshiping Him with your tithes. A lot of churches are having to close doors, but we just thank God we have faithful members that are coming and continue to worship in their giving. So we thank God for that. Our food breakdown will be Friday, starting at 9 a.m. And 6 p.m. And food distribution will be Saturday at 9 a.m. This will be the same as it was last month. Our priority is safety. So we will have people coming out to the vehicles. If you're one of those people that's coming in, just remain in your vehicles. We'll have people coming around, sign you up, and then drive around and we'll load the food. And Sunday, April 26th, this will be our teen takeover service. NC4C will be here. Youth Pastor Freddie Holbrook will be bringing the message. So you will be blessed by that service. We have a great group of teens. So we thank God. I'm going to pray, and then we'll have our popcorn message. Father God, we just come before you, giving you praise this morning. Lord God, we thank you for just new opportunities, Lord God, to reach your people. We pray, Lord God, that you will find your way into somebody's heart this morning. So they may be broken down, they may be hurting, they may be feeling a loss or sickness, but we know that you're the cure for each and every symptom, Lord God. So we just pray that you just have your way, continue to bless this service, and use this for your glory. And we'll give you the praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
Come on, popcorn! Good morning, boys and girls. Well, hello, Rovercomer. Rovercomer? Hey, Rovercomer! Whoa. Sorry, I didn't mean to scare you. You look like you're really into that Bible this morning. You're charging up your faith? He says, without faith, it is impossible to please God. He said, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. He said, that's why it's important to come to church and to read your Bible, for faith. He said, he's got a story to tell us about a time when he had real weak faith. He said he was going to go visit his Uncle Bob and Cousin Steve. He said Bob and Steve are good people, but they didn't really go to church. And he said he was there all summer long. And since they didn't go to church, he didn't go to church either. Now, Rover Comer, he said he didn't even read his Bible one time. And he said him and Steve were outside playing. And said Steve jumped up in the air and come down on his paw and went, oh! He said, Steve, are you okay? And Steve said, I wish something would help my paw. It hurt so bad. And Rover Comer said, I knew I was going to pray for Steve. But my faith was so weak, I hadn't heard the Bible. I didn't know what to say. He said, the only thing I could say was, Lord, help my cousin Steve. He said, I wish I'd had more faith. He said, I could have been a light to my uncle and to my cousin. And I made a vow that day that my faith would never be weak again, that I was going to go to church when I could, I was going to read the Bible at home, I was going to ask my master to help me read the Bible, because Romans 10:17 says, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. That's a really good story. Thank you, Rover Comer. Thank you so much. Tell the boys and girls bye. We'll see them soon. Bye, guys.
Don't know the cost.
oil in my alabaster box. I can't forget the way life used to be, and I was a prisoner to the sin that had me bound. I spent my days pouring my life without measure into a little treasure box I thought I had found, until the day when Jesus came to me and he healed my soul with the wonder of his touch. So now I'm giving back to him all the praise he's worthy of. I've been forgiven, and that's why I love him so much. When I come to pour my praise on him like oil from Mary's alabaster box. Thank you, Jesus. Don't be angry if I wash his feet with my tears and I dry them with my hair. You were there when Jesus found me. You did not feel what I felt when he wrapped his loving arms around me. And you don't know the cost of the oil. No, you don't know the cost of my praise. You don't know the cost of the oil.
Praise God. Just want to thank Minister Pam Kane for those beautiful songs. Also want to thank Rover Comer and Minister Matt Justice. And Matt and Heather Justice have a beautiful webpage called Peace on the Mountain. And if you haven't had a chance to go there and look at that site, you need to go ahead and do that. And it will really, really bless you with the writings and the inspired word. And I think he and I were on the same page the other day, but him and Heather do a good job. She has some beautiful pictures on there. So please check it out. And we always thank God for overcoming. Amen. So we do give God the praise today. I was listening to my Bible on the phone. That sounds funny. I wasn't reading my Bible. I was listening to it on the phone. And I got distracted for a minute. And then all of a sudden, something caught my ear of what was being said. And I turned around and I said, who are they talking? Who's he talking about? And then I was listening to Proverbs. And I'm going, what? Who is that? And I know I read it before, but for some reason or another, it caught my mind this time. And I'm going to read you the scripture that it was going on, and then you'll know who it was also. And as I did this, as I say, it really caught my mind. So it's from Proverbs chapter 8, starting at verse 22. And it reads as this: the Lord possesses me at the beginning of his way. Before his works of old, I have been established from everlasting. From the beginning, before there was ever an earth, when there was no depth, I was brought forth. when there were no fountains abounding with water, before the mountains were settled, before the hills, I was brought forth. While as yet he had not made the earth or the fields or the dust of the world, when he prepared the heavens, I was there. When he drew a circle on the face of the depth, when he established the clouds above, when he strengthened the fountains of the deep, when he assigned the sea its limits, so that the water would not transgress his command, when he marked out the foundation of the earth, then I was beside him a master craftsman, and I was daily his delight, rejoicing always before him, rejoicing in the inhabited world. And my delight was with the sons of man. Now therefore, listen to me, my children, for blessed are those who keep my way. Hear the instructions and be wise, and do not disdain it. Blessed is the man who listens to me, watching daily at my gates, waiting at the post of my doors. For whoever finds me finds life and obtains favor from the Lord. But he who sins against me wrongs his own soul, and those who hate me love death. Chapter 9, verse 10, it's one verse. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. And that's who the psalmist, Solomon at this time, in Proverbs was writing about. He was writing about wisdom, and the Bible usually refers to wisdom with a C. But I want to use the subject today, spiritual wisdom. Most gracious and eternal God, Father, again, you take over. Thank you, Lord, for teaching me. And God, just have your way. Let me say everything that you want me to say and not anything that you don't want me to say. And Lord, I will never fail to give you the praise in Jesus' name. You guys won't believe it, but I've been in this thing almost 37 years now, and I've been a pastor, and I don't think I've ever spoke on wisdom. I've brought it up a few times, but I've never just talked about it. And I began to do a in-depth study in wisdom. I'm going to hit some high spots, but I would challenge you and ask you to go back. If you've never studied about wisdom, spiritual wisdom, then you go back and look and begin to get your concordance out and everything, and just begin to look at it, because when we don't know about spiritual wisdom, we miss something. Wisdom is a quality pre-creation possession of God. That's what it is. Its benefits are blessings, life, and favor. And Webster defines wisdom as knowledge. But I'm talking about spiritual wisdom. I'm talking about spiritual wisdom. Amen. Wisdom and spiritual wisdom is not the same. See, you can know all the facts, the truths, and the principle, but if you don't apply that information to your life, you're not very wise. Amen. Spiritual wisdom is not just knowing what's good for you, but it's applying that knowledge to your everyday life. You have to use it. Wisdom is a very real practical sense of what we do, how we do it, and why it must be done. And so wisdom is more than common sense. And you hear people sometimes, man, they're smart. They know it, but they ain't got no common sense. In fact, I'm sure you probably know some folks, man, that as far as book learning and knowing stuff and things like that, man, they can't function because they don't have no common sense. So there's a big difference, you know. So somebody might have wisdom, they might have knowledge, you know, but they don't have common sense. And so even though we have that, It's still, wisdom is more than even common sense. A wise person may not always choose what is commonly regarded as the best and the safest and most popular course. And I would have to tell you, I'm one of those with this ministry sometimes. The things that God was leading me to do through the Holy Spirit didn't make sense a lot of times. That we came over the years, the 30 years that we've been going, but sometimes it was, you know, to be wise and things, people say, whoa, no, that ain't the way you do it. And sometimes when you're listening to the spiritual wisdom, you stand alone. Because folks think you lost your mind when you listen to the spiritual wisdom and stuff. But because, and so what it is that they might deem, may not be what God deems best. And so a lot of times, the thing that God deems best or thinks best for us may not line up with a wise choice sometimes. Somebody say amen in your house right now. But knowledge alone is not enough. You can have the best and you can have the brightest, but that's no guarantee that you're going to make a wise decision. And so the first step to spiritual wisdom is learning to bow down to God. Let me say it again. The first step of spiritual wisdom is learning to bow down to God. If we don't acknowledge God, we're certainly not going to benefit from his guidance. And that's why verse 10 said, the fear of the Lord, and that's that reverence and respect for God, is the beginning of wisdom. And he acknowledges the Holy One, and the knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. So you got to get God right there first. And so you have to understand this. There's a difference. Okay, does having spiritual wisdom, or does having wisdom guarantee that we always act wisely? It didn't with Solomon. And Solomon started off good. God gave him a blank check. Gave him a blank check. He said, whatever you want, whatever you want, you can have. And that's what he told him. And so Solomon asked God, out of all the things he could have had, he asked God for wisdom. Why did he ask God for wisdom? I'm glad you asked. Because he wanted to be able to lead God's people in the way that God wanted him to. In 2 Chronicles chapter 1, verse 10, and this here's what Solomon said. Now give me wisdom and knowledge that I may go out and come in before the people. For who can judge this great people of yours? Then God said to Solomon, because this is in your heart, and you have not asked for riches or wealth to honor or the life of your enemies, nor have you asked for long life, but have asked wisdom and knowledge for yourself, that you may judge my people over whom I have made you king. Wisdom and knowledge are granted to you, and I will give you riches and wealth and honor, such as none of the kings have had who were before you, not sure any after you have that life. In other words, God said, you asked for wisdom to do my will, to follow, to lead my people. And he said, and because you asked for wisdom and because this thing is from your heart, I'm going to give you everything else that you didn't ask for. So we find that if you want to be wise, make the choice and then act. You got to make the choice that you're going to follow God, and then you got to act on it. Later on, Solomon allowed his foreign wives. He married all these foreign women, his foreign wives, and he allowed them to worship their pagan god, which led him to allow idol worship in Israel, and then to divide the nations, and could not pass on the wisdom to his kids. And I ask you this, I leave you with this, and like I said, I'm hitting the high spot, but I want you to dig on this thing. Do we desire God's blessings? Do we seek God's wisdom? Or do we just go our own way? Or as we used to say, do our own thing. Guys, listen. We have the book of wisdom. But knowing the truth isn't helpful until we're willing to be transformed by it. How many times have you heard somebody, and I know people like this too, with that, they'll say, man, they ain't saved, but they know the word. They ain't saved. They don't know the Lord. They don't go to church. They don't do this. But they know that word like the back of the head. They can tell you that word. Well, to me, that's foolish. To me, and you can't fix stupid. If you know this word, if you know this word, and you read this word, and you understand this book of wisdom, and you know this word, and then you haven't asked Jesus Christ to come into your life, you haven't accepted him as your Lord and Savior, I'm telling you, something wrong with you. What we do with what we know depends on us. What you do with what you know depends on you. God gives us opportunities to use his wisdom and his discernment. And that's one of the things that I pray about for this church all the time, and each one of you, that you would have a spirit of discernment. And that's why I tell you, when you come in here, don't hang your brain on the doorpost. You know, use your mind. You know, if you listen to some of the stuff I see on TV sometimes, oh my goodness. And people fall for that, and they go along with that, and they just hang on anything that's been said, and they never check it out themselves. Something's wrong. And you say you know, but God gives us opportunity to use his wisdom and use his discernment. Let me read one more verse to you, and it comes from James chapter 5. If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all liberally without reproach, and it will be given to him. God says, I'll give it to you. Amen. I'll give it to you to use for the glory of God. I'll give it to you. And so there are sometimes, guys, that I'm talking to people, I'm dealing with a situation, and I say, I don't know how I'm going to do this. I don't know how I'm going to handle this. I don't know what I'm going to say, but the Holy Ghost, great God in his eye. I know I can't help talking about the Holy Ghost, but the Holy Ghost will bring those things to remembrance. And first of all, you got to know it. You got to know, how is the Holy Ghost going to bring something to your remembrance if you don't know it in the first time? Wait, you got to know it first. And then the next thing you got to do is you got to apply it. Romans 12 said, be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. So, if I wanted to wrap this thing up, I'd leave it to you like this. Spiritual wisdom is not just knowing, but it's doing. Be a doer of the word and not a hearer only. For if any be a hearer of the word and not a doer, it's like a man beholding himself in a mirror. I pray to God that you have that spiritual wisdom. I pray to God that you have that godly sacrifice. And in the time that we're in, and all the things that are going on, and all that we've been bombarded with, Lord knows you need spiritual wisdom. Here's your roadmap. B-I-B-L-E. Basic instruction before leaving earth. Get into it. Know it and live it. Know it and live it. If you want to be pleasing, if you want to have life, if you want to be full of God's presence, then be a doer of this word. Hey guys, as always, thank God for being able to come into your house. I'm praying that all this stuff will be over with soon, and I'll get to see you face to face, and we'll be together again. But as a man, and you know it, I love you, and ain't nothing you can do about it. God bless you.
Praise God, church. We thank God for that word. We thank God for its truth. As Pastor Scott was speaking, I couldn't help but think of Saul. You know, Saul studied under all the great teachers, and he knew the word, but he lacked one thing, and that was the knowledge of Jesus Christ being his Savior. So that's the key to wisdom, is you can know a lot of books, but if you don't have an intimate relationship with Jesus, what a fool indeed. So we pray that you come to know Jesus. If you don't know him, or if someone in your family is lost, that they come to know our great Lord and Savior. So as we get ready to dismiss, as always, we enter into, we're going to depart to, most gracious Heavenly Father. Lord God, we thank you for your word, and we thank you for its truth. We thank you for the wisdom, Lord God, that is in your word and is a roadmap of instruction for us here on this earth. So Lord, we write it in our hearts, Lord God, that we would walk in your word, and you would just lead and guide our path. Bless each and everything that we do, for we do it to give your name the glory. And we just exalt your name each and every day, Lord. So be with those families that home. We just pray special blessings over them, Lord God, that you will just be in the midst each and every moment. And we just give you the praise in Jesus' name. Amen.